In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. Have mercy on us, O Lord.
For we have sinned against you.
Show us, O Lord, your mercy.
And grant us your salvation.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
You have bestowed, that all may grasp and rightly understand in what font they have been washed, by whose spirit they have been reborn, by whose blood they have been redeemed. For our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
From the Acts of the Apostles. They devoted themselves to the teaching of the apostles and to the communal life, to the breaking of bread and to the prayers. Awe came upon everyone, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their property and possessions and divide them among all, according to each one's need. Every day, they devoted themselves to meeting together in the temple area and to breaking bread in their homes. They ate their meals with exultation and sincerity of heart, praising God and enjoying favor with all the people. And every day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, His love is
St. Peter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in his great mercy gave us a new birth to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who, by the power of God, are safeguarded through faith, to a salvation that is ready to be revealed in the final time. In this you rejoice, although now for a little while you may have to suffer through various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that is perishable even though tested by fire, may prove to be praise, glory, and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Although you have not seen him, you love him. Even though you do not see him now, yet believe in him. You rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy as you attain the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
On the evening of that first day of the week, when the doors were locked, where the disciples were for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive are forgiven them, and whose sins you retain are retained." Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with him when Jesus came. But the other disciples said to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger into the nail marks and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Now a week later, his disciples were again inside and Thomas was with them. Jesus came, although the doors were locked, and stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and bring your hand and put it into my side. And do not be unbelieving, but believe." Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you come to believe because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples that are not written in this book. But these are written that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that through this belief you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good morning.
Good morning.
When Jesus appeared to his apostles in the upper room, as we just heard in John's gospel, Jesus would have had every right as a human to look at his apostles and say to them, "Hey guys, where were you? When I needed you the most, where were you? You all vanished like puffs of smoke, running. Only my mother Mary, John the beloved apostle, and a few other women stayed during my hour of need. They walked with me all through Good Friday up until my passion and death on the cross. Where were you guys?" He had every right, he could have done that. But if you notice, what are his first words to his apostles? "Peace be with you." He doesn't hold a grudge. Instead, he extends to them his divine mercy. And not only that, he goes further, but invites them into his mission of mercy. By breathing on them and saying to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive are forgiven them, whose sins you retain are retained." He invites them into this new relationship with God. Saint John Paul II, Pope Saint John Paul II, wanted us to continue to examine this continual mission of Jesus, this mission of mercy. And he often spoke of it. And I wrote a line that I included in your homily that you can have in your bulletin. And this line I thought was very beautiful. He said, "It is God's merciful love that firmly unites the church today as in the past and makes humanity a single family." That's the one thing we often think about. We're all united and practically in the same boat when it comes to sin. We all struggle, we're all weak. Yes, we all know that. But if we flip that coin to the other side, we are all also equally loved by God. He died for all of us. So sin and salvation unite us in the family of God. Not only us here present in the world today, but humanity in the past, humanity in the future. We're all one family. Now today is the Divine Mercy Sunday, the second Sunday of Easter. And St. Pope John Paul II is the one who instituted Divine Mercy. For those of you who may not be familiar, for those who may know, just a refresher, October the 5th, 1938, if I'm not mistaken, was 38. Sister Faustina, and I'm sorry about the last name, my Polish is terrible. In fact, I know no Polish. Kolowska, who was a congregation of the Sisters of Mercy, Our Lady of Mercy, passed away in Poland. This would have honestly not been of worldwide notice, but St. Faustina had, for the 4 years prior to her death, kept a diary of mystical experiences that she had with the resurrected Jesus, the same Jesus who appeared to the apostles, appeared to Faustina, and wanted to again stress to humanity his divine mercy. Now, he did not add anything that he hasn't already revealed. So please don't think it's an addition or a new teaching. It emphasized the thing that he always said. I love you, I died for you. Seek my mercy and you'll have my mercy. But there was one line that Jesus said to Faustina that has struck me. And I want to read, it's about a paragraph, I want to read it to you because every time I come across this one little section as I reread this diary, it always grips my heart. Jesus said to her, "My heart overflows with great mercy for souls, and especially for poor sinners. If only they could understand that I am the best of fathers to them, and that it is for them that the blood and water flowed from my heart as from a fount overflowing with mercy. For them I dwell in the tabernacle as King of Mercy. I desire to bestow my grace upon souls, but they do not want to accept it. Oh, how indifferent are souls to so much goodness, to so many proofs of love. My heart drinks only of the ingratitude and forgetfulness of souls living in the world. They have time for everything, but they have no time to come for me for graces." And I say it gets to me every time, because since Good Friday, what has Jesus' message been to us? I died for you. Care. Care about what I did. And show it to me by the way you treat yourself, each other, and me. I said the divine mercy is not anything new. Our statue of the Sacred Heart of Jesus, similarly of the same ilk, it'll show Christ. If you never had the opportunity to go up and look at it, go up and look at it after Mass. But you'll see the heart of Jesus with the crown of thorns around his heart. Why are they there? He explained to St. Margaret Mary Alacoque. They're there because men are indifferent. I did this for them. My heart burns with desire. I love humanity. I love every person. But people, the most they do is give me basically an eh. And you think about it, it's so true. We make time for everything. Do we make time for God? You know, if we're honest, with ourselves. God is always willing to give us mercy. He only asks one thing of us. He says, you want my mercy? Receive it. I'll give it to you. I died for you. You just have to do one thing. Confess. Be reconciled back to me. And we have that through the sacrament of reconciliation, confession. But yet, if you notice, people more than happy to get their child baptized, more than happy to go up to communion, more than happy to get confirmed, more than, everybody wants to get married in the church. The bigger the church, the longer the aisle, the more you want to get married. You think about all, everybody wants those. But when it comes to his mercy and the sacrament of reconciliation, all of a sudden we become deaf, dumb, and mute. We're like those three little monkeys. Hear no evil, see no evil, do no evil. You know? Why do we diminish that sacrament and we don't diminish the rest? Did you ever wonder? Why is it that one's always placed to the back burner? And that's the one that you and I need the most. But yet we try to rationalize our way out of it. Jesus did everything. His passion saved me. Therefore, everything I do, it's all paid up by the blood of Jesus. I've heard that. And I thought to myself, well, that's quite nice. Think about it. Okay, most of you have had kids. If not, I pray one day you do have children. So you can experience the joy of the way you treat your parents. You know? That's why I became a priest. I don't want to see another young Will Soshay. But you stop and you think about it. When your kids were growing up, if they played baseball and they hit the ball and broke the neighbor's window, and they came up to you and said, Mom, Dad, out there playing ball, I broke the neighbor's window. And you said, okay, go tell him you're sorry. I already did that to God. I told him in my room. I'm good to go, Mom, Dad. Okay. Well, you're going to have to pay for the neighbor's window. Mom, Dad, Jesus already paid for it. I'm good to go. Would that fly as an excuse? No, I couldn't get away with that. Nobody could. But yet we use that same type of thought when it comes to other things that we do to each other. And let's be honest, how easy is it? If I offend you, it's easy for me to just go into my house, close the door and say, okay, God, I'm sorry. I'm good to go. Do I need to reconcile back with you? You would hope I would, but no necessary. That's easy to do. Doesn't take anybody to do that. But is it what we're supposed to do? I argue no. And I don't argue it from Catholicism. Hey, let's go back to the Old Testament. Old Testament. Y'all remember that? Good old days. That's why they called the Old Testament. The good old days. Okay. If you were going to make a sin offering to God in the Old Testament, what would you do? You would get your offering. Let's say it's going to be a lamb. You got your lamb. Nice, pretty lamb. Where are you going to bring it? To the temple. And who are you going to give it to? The priest. And what is the priest going to do? They're going to prepare it. They're going to offer it up to God as your sin offering. God will get a portion. The priest gets a portion. Guess what's given back to you from the hands of the priest? The mercy of God. It's not Catholic, that was from our Jewish ancestors. And then we, when Catholicism or Christianity, they're synonymous when they started. Remember, what was Jesus? A Christian? No, he was Jewish. Or the apostles, they're Jewish. Or the early Christians, they were of Jewish descent. So when they started to pray and worship, how are they going to pray and worship? In their style that they know. Jewish. So what did they do? They related things to being Jewish. So in Jewish prayer, would you have just offered your lamb on your back porch and said, here you go, God, I'm offering it, everything's taken care of? No. You went to the temple, you offered it to the priest, etc., and so forth. You think I'm crazy? Go read the Old Testament. It's very specific on sacrifices and what should be offered. But we have now said, you don't need to do that. You don't need to go to a priest. He's just a man. Don't do that. Just confess to God and you're good to go. If we look at the New Testament, that same logic was used against Jesus. In the story of the man who's paralytic, they open up the roof and the ceiling, they let him down. Jesus' first words to him are, my son, your sins are forgiven you. Same thing. And they look at him and the leaders at the time and they say, who is this? He's just a man. He can't forgive sins. Only God forgives sins. And Jesus responds by saying, to show to you that the Son of a man, the Son of man, the Son of a man, a human, can forgive sins through the power of God, I say to you, paralyzed man, rise, take up your mat and walk. The guy does it. He breathes on Peter. He says to him, you are Peter, the rock I'm going to build my church. I give to you the kings of the kingdom. What you declare bound on earth shall be bound in heaven. Loose on earth, loosed in heaven. He doesn't stop there because he's God and he's merciful. He knows that we will continue to fall. So what does he do? He gives to the apostles that you heard in John's gospel today. He gives to them that same power. He breathes on them and says, receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive or forgive them, whose sins you retain or retain. God still wants to offer us mercy all the time. The only thing we have to do is ask for it. And we as Christians, as Catholics, believe, how do we ask for it? We ask for it through the hands of the minister, through the hands of the priest. We go to the sacrament of reconciliation and hear the priest say to us, your sins are forgiven, go in peace. Where did that idea of we just need to confess to God come from? Do you know? We've all heard it. You see? Everybody says it to us, but if you ever to ask someone, well, where did that come from? They're not going to be able to tell you. What that came from, history lesson. I know I'm going a little bit long, but it's fun for me, actually. History lesson. In the Reformation, some of the followers, later reformers, wanted to pull or wrest control away from the Catholic Church. How do you take power away from the Catholic Church so that it doesn't influence your village, your city, your community? Well, you get rid of the priest. No priest, no Catholic Church to have power. So if you notice, and trust me, the Catholic Church was not nothing to write home about during the Middle Ages. It had some pretty outlandish activity. But if you notice, so much of it centered on what can we do in which we don't have to have the priesthood? And you look at it. You don't need to go to a priest. Just go to God. You don't need a priest for communion. We'll just get together and have communion.
And you can see, historically, connections. You can think I'm wrong, you can think I'm crazy. Not wrong, maybe a little crazy, but go back and research it. Trust me, just go back and research it. And we look at these things, it's there. And then after Vatican II, one of the sad things I heard, as I heard priests, while I sat there in congregations, like you do today, I heard priests say, oh, you don't need to go to confession unless you do something big. Okay. Think of it this way. Acorn from an oak tree falls on your roof, lands in your gutter, and an oak tree, a live oak, starts to grow in your gutter. Are you going to wait till the live oak tree is very big before you remove it from your gutter and it doesn't tear up your roof? Or are you going to notice it when it's small and try to get rid of it? Common sense says we take it out when it's small, right? But the priest who said, don't wait, go to confession only when you do something big, they would tell you have to wait till the oak tree is about 5-6 feet around, growing on top of your house, then you can remove it. That's their logic. It doesn't make one bit of sense. If it's been over a year, go. Honestly, if you think about it, in business we do it once a quarter, that we do quarterly reports in business. Go once a quarter. Give God a quarterly report. But I'll end on this, and I promise you I will end on this. Sometimes, and it's been my experience also, sometimes when you go into the sacrament of reconciliation, when you're there humbly asking for the mercy of God and wanting to receive it, you come across a priest as minister who leaves a lot to be desired. And that priest sometimes will yell at you. They may even belittle you. If that ever has happened to you, and I say this because I've been on the receiving end. It drove me away from the church for a period of time. Don't do what I did. Don't make the same mistake. Just get up and walk out. I remember that priest said something and, well, walk out. Go find another priest. Don't judge your faith by the fallacies of one minister. Don't ever do that. Just go and find another priest. And pray for that fellow. All right. That's enough. Almighty God be with you. May he bless you. The Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Let us stand for our profession of faith, our creed. I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God, begotten, not made, or unsubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For our sin and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit, was born of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified and washed violent. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is Lord and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for forgiveness of sins. And I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Coming together as one family in faith, let us offer to God our prayers and our needs.
Rejoicing in this day that the Lord has made, let us pray for all those who are in need, for Pope Francis and all leaders at every level of our church, as they encourage us to grow in faith, believing even though we have not seen. Let us pray to the Lord.
The Lord, hear our prayer.
For all nations in conflict and for all people in distress because of war, especially those driven by desperation to seek refuge in other lands, let us pray to the Lord.
The Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who listen to God's word today, that we might learn from the example of the early Christians and share what we have for the benefit of all, let us pray to the Lord.
The Lord, hear our prayer.
For all newly initiated Christians, especially those among us who were baptized last week at the Easter Vigil, as witness of their new faith, strengthens each of us in our own faith, let us pray to the Lord.
The Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have no faith, for those who have lost their faith, for those whose faith is faltering, that they might see and experience Christ in our community of faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions in our prayer book, Valerie Christiana, Christine Ray, Solange Spencer, Pam Cotes, Barbara Ball, Audrey and Josephia Burris, Mrs. John H. Burris, Austin Ledbetter, Frank, Sarah, Will, and family, Horton Bacchus family, Keelan Smith, Rachel Kylick, Debbie Kelly, Dominic D'Agostino Jr., rest in peace, Terry Smith, rest in peace, Daryl Kovage, Francis Lewis, and for special intention, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the prayers that we hold in the silence of our hearts, for all our intentions, spoken and unspoken, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And let us pray for you, the parishioners of St. Thomas and St. Bridget parishes. For you, this Mass is being offered today, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Offering all our prayers to the Father, let us conclude with a prayer in honor of the Blessed Trinity. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Our offertory hymn can be found on page 239, number 247, I Received the Living God, number 247 on page 239.
Jesus.
pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
And may the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise of the Lord and his name, for our good and good of all the holy church.
Accept, O Lord, we pray, the oblations of your people, that renewed by confession of your name and by baptism, they may attain unending happiness. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation at all times, to acclaim you, O Lord. But on this day, above all, to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying, he has destroyed our death, and by rising, restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise. And even the heavenly powers with the angelic all sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. For us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Thomas, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all that have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the Blessed Joseph, her spouse, the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress. So we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom and power and the glory of yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Live not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. And graciously grant our peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Please join me in the communion chant. It will be found on page 84. Bring your hand and feel the place of the nails, and do not be unbelieving, but believing. Alleluia.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that our reception of this Paschal Sacrament may have a continuing effect in our minds and hearts through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go in peace. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.
Just before you go, remember to take home a bulletin because there's some announcements in it, especially the bingo from the ladies' auxiliary, if you'd like to be a part of that. And on your way out, if you go out the main doors, there's the Word Among Us. It is the Easter edition, and that's free for you. If we run out, there's some in a brown box right near it. Please take one, okay? And they're good till May the 31st, so please take one. All right. Y'all have a great day. Thank y'all. Prayer to St. Michael.
Holy Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And to you, O Prince of the heavenly hosts, by the divine power, for us in the hell, Satan and all the other evil spirits, who wander through the world seeking the ruin of souls.
Amen. Divine praises. Blessed be God.
Blessed be his holy name.
Blessed be Jesus Christ, his God, true man.
Blessed be the name of Jesus.
Blessed be his most sacred heart.
Blessed be his most precious blood.
Blessed be Jesus, the most holy sacrament of the altar.
Blessed be the Holy Spirit, the consoler.
Blessed be the great mother of God, Mary, most holy.
Blessed be your holy and immaculate conception.
Blessed be your glorious assumption.
Blessed be the name of Mary, virgin mother.
Blessed be Saint Joseph, her most chaste spouse.
Our recessional hymn can be found on page 299, number 337, Hymn of Joy, number 337 on page 299.